like to keep my speech short and I want to make only 2 points in this speech. For several years, it has been a matter of controversy whether the highly able are in need of good educators or the highly challenged are in need of good educators. This seminar was organized to bring into light what educators bring to educate the highly able can do for them. Obviously, the highly challenged need good educators so that they can overcome the handicap and lead a life in which they can get more in the mainstream. If the highly able cannot merge in the mainstream, and if they stand out because of their above average ability, can that be a matter of humanitarian concern? When the highly challenged are not yet taken adequately taken care of, I think that the highly able as individuals need not be a matter of concern. And how should we look upon the above average abilities of the highly able? During the last decade, there has been a lot of talk about the demographic dividend in India. The population of any country consists of people of all ages, from the newly born to those of 65 or 75 or even those who are in their 80s or 90s. The children below 15 years and the senior citizens above 65 or 75 years, they generally cannot contribute to the economic prosperity of the country. If the proportion of these two age groups is large and the working population has to take the responsibility of these two age groups, then people say that these two age groups are the demographic liability of the country. But the responsibility of the younger generation can be taken as investment for the future. The responsibility of the senior citizens can be considered as an expression of gratitude. But this outlook is emotional and moral. Economically, it has still a liability. On the other hand, if the young and adult population, working population, is larger in proportion than the children and the senior citizens, this middle age group can produce more and create a surplus which will remain even after the investment and the expression of gratitude. When there is such a large proportion of the surplus creating age group in the population, that age group is called as the demographic dividend of the country. Now this middle age group, the working and the earning group in the society, works and earns because they have various abilities. Just as the population has people of different ages, a particular age group also has people having more or less abilities. All working people can and do contribute to the prosperity of the society. Those with less ability will contribute less. Those with more ability will contribute more. It is in the interest of the society that those with high ability contribute fully according to their abilities. So the highly able should be motivated and trained to utilize their abilities to the maximum extent. Just as the high proportion of the working and earning population is a demographic dividend for the country, the abilities of the highly able form the ability dividend of the society or of the country. And when we are thinking about, discussing about the education of the highly able, we should think with how to make use of this ability dividend for the society. I could never digest the argument that the highly people, highly able, need special care just like the highly challenged. And those who are involved in the education of the highly able, if they put forward this argument, they get into trouble. As individuals, the highly able can fend for themselves. They are not in need of any compassion. They may avail of the opportunities available for the mainstream population and take care of themselves. But it is seen that under such circumstances, the abilities of the highly able remain underutilized, and that is a loss to the society. The highly able are sources of innovation, invention, entrepreneurship, and excellence in the society. These are all required for the progress of the society. So, these abilities cannot be then individual resources. They are also the resources of the society. It is necessary that the highly able are made to realize the role of their abilities in the development of the society, and also their responsibility to utilize those abilities for social and national development. To bring about this realization in them is the first objective of education of the highly able. The second objective is to motivate them to act upon this realization. And the third objective is to assist them in nurturing these abilities for social and national cause. All persons have some abilities which can be utilized for social and national progress. So these objectives can be the objectives of mainstream education also. But these objectives definitely cannot be the objectives of the education of highly challenged at the current state of their education. A country like India lags behind many other countries in science, technology, industry, education, and in human development indices. The education of the highly able with the above three objectives can produce a leveraging effect, that is, more impact with similar inputs which are then given in the mainstream education. And this is necessary, produce this leveraging effect is necessary in a country deficient of motivated and capable people. To meet these objectives of education, the educators will have to be trained in a different way over and above the training they may receive as educators of the mainstream population. How the educators of the highly able should be trained is one aspect of this issue, and you have been discussing about that the whole day. The second aspect is how to identify the highly able and which abilities should be looked for. I myself heard about this term highly able only during the last 20 years. When I was the principal of the school in Jnana, Prabodhini, I was always talking about the gifted, academically gifted, intellectually gifted, gifted and talented. Highly able is a more general term. Many people think it is politically correct term. But I think that there are other aspects to this also. Jnana Prabodhini has been doing research on the Guilford model of intelligence for several years. Many others in Jnana Prabodhini also are attracted by the Gardner's model of intelligence. There are few other models also. I feel that to plan for the education of highly able in India, we should have an Indian model of human abilities and not only that of intelligence. In the Indian model of human abilities, the first requirement is that intelligence cannot be considered in isolation. Intelligence is one aspect of the inner instrument, antahkarana. Along with intelligence or buddhi, the other three aspects of this inner instrument or antahkarana are manas or man or mind, chitta, which cannot be translated into English and it is truly translated as mind stuff, and antahkarana or the ego. These four aspects of antahkarana, the inner instrument, are expressed outwardly in 60 different ways. I will not go in their Sanskrit names or Indian names. I will use more familiar terms in English. The first aspect is sensation. The second aspect is perception. These two are generally not considered as parts of intelligence in the modern psychology. Then there is cognition, knowledge, wisdom, insight, outlook, perspective, and vision. These seven can be considered as aspects of intelligence even in modern psychology. But the Indian model does not end here. Beyond that, one aspect is the burst of action to realize the vision. Recollection of one's real nature. Resolution to realize this vision, and to stabilize the recollection of the real nature. Planned efforts to realize the vision, not just burst of action, but planned efforts. Concentration of all energy in these planned efforts. Intense desire to realize the vision and our real nature. And total control of all our faculties to realize the vision. Obviously, the last seven are still not considered as part of or aspects of intelligence. They can be considered, they are considered as vital, emotional, spiritual, or personality factors. But according to the Indian model, they are all aspects, all the 16 forms, they are all aspects of prajnana. And prajnana is described as the individualized component of cosmic intelligence. Even if you keep aside the last seven aspects of this prajnana, the aspects of cognition to vision can be considered initially as the abilities to be nurtured, and those having these abilities need to be motivated. The educators of the highly able should be trained to identify and nurture these abilities, motivate the able, and make them realize that though these abilities are residing within them, they are part of their social, national, and cosmic heritage. So these are the two points which I wanted to make, that the highly able have abilities which form the ability dividend of our country, and it is the responsibility, duty of the society as a whole to make maximum use of these abilities in national progress. Of course, when I say we have to motivate the highly able, in some way, one way or the other, we'll have to make them volunteer to use their abilities for national and social progress. They cannot be ordered. they will have to be made to volunteer to do that. So that is the first aspect. And the second aspect, when we are considering of education of the highly able in India, I think it is better that we consider the Indian model of higher ability, of abilities, human abilities. And even if you have started with aspects of intelligence, we will have to take all personality factors when we are trying to educate the highly able. Thank you.